know, graveyards are not usually associated with joy and hope. If you are depressed and feeling bad, one of the least likely places in which you would consider finding relief and release is a graveyard. The great scientific discoveries that have done so much to revolutionize our daily living have been made in all kinds of places and under all kinds of circumstances. Nothing of scientific significance, however, has ever been discovered in a graveyard. The great battles of history have been fought in all kinds of places, on land and on the sea, in the air and on the plains, on mountains and valleys, in great cities and even humble villages. However, no great battles have been fought in graveyards. And with the exception, I believe, of the Gettysburg Address, no great speeches or pronouncements from orators, ministers, poets, or rulers have been made in graveyards. If you ever want to see something of significance or hear something good, the last place that you would consider looking is a graveyard. The graveyards, after all, are for dead folk. And as we all know, dead people do not move or speak. And speaking as the son of a funeral director, even if I ever did see it myself, I wouldn't stay around long enough to continue to view it.
Amen.
Yet if Easter is about anything, it is about the good news that comes out of the graveyard.
Amen.
Easter. Perhaps the biggest and most significant observance of the Christian faith comes out of a borrowed tomb of all places, in a graveyard. Easter, with all of the joy and all of the hope that it brings, was set in a graveyard. It didn't occur at the banks of the Jordan River with the heavens opening up and the Spirit of God descending like a dove and the voice of God thundering forth, but in all places, a lonely graveyard. Didn't take place on the Mount of Transfiguration or in the busy streets of Jerusalem amidst the cheering crowds on Palm Sunday, but in a lonely graveyard. If Easter, beloved, is about anything, it is the announcement and celebration of the good news that love conquers hate.
Amen.
Right conquers wrong. And nonviolence defeats violence. It is the message that good, though seemingly always on the run and on the ropes, can still conquer evil. And that holiness, without compromising itself or stooping to use the methods of the opponent, can still defeat sin. If the fact that all of this good news comes out of the graveyard seems strange to you like it did to me, let me remind you that Christianity itself is a strange faith.
Yes.
To begin with, its premise is the strange assertion that a God whose greatness and magnitude is beyond comprehension is concerned about and cares for and loves puny, insignificant human beings so much that to save us, this God became one with us and one of us. And if that sounds strange, listen here. Christianity would have you believe not was born in a stable to poor parents and an oppressed people in one of the smallest countries in the world. And when he was born, angels sang not to the high priest and the religious leaders, but they sang to the lowly shepherds. Yes. Oh, and if that sounds strange, here we go. Christianity would have you believe that this God, being born a human, associated with fishermen and tax collectors and prostitutes and all kinds of what we would call low class common people. And if that sounds strange, listen to this. Christianity would have you believe that when Jesus, the God-man, rode into Jerusalem as a king, he didn't ride in a chariot. He was not in somebody's Cadillac, but he was on a donkey. And that he was greeted not with trumpets, but with palms. His army consisted not of trained soldiers, but of ordinary poor men and women, girls and boys. Who ever heard of a king riding on a donkey without armed soldiers of the Secret Service around, without royal robes, without blasting trumpets? I'm not done. If that sounds strange, here's something else. Christianity would have you believe that even though he could have called 10,000 angels,
amen,
to destroy the world and set him free,
yes,
Jesus allowed himself to be beaten and bruised and judged in the kangaroo courts of ancient Palestine and then be crucified, yes, between two thieves like one of the worst criminals in history. And that sounds strange? This same Jesus who opened blinded eyes and cut loose stammering tongues and healed the sick and raised the dead and who calmed the raging seas claimed that it would be Calvary with all of its pain and shame that would glorify and exalt him. It was this same Jesus who said, and if I be lifted up from the earth, will draw all people unto myself. So then, when one considers how strange the Christian faith is anyway, it's not strange after all that the good news that it has for all of humankind emanates from, comes out of a graveyard. Just what is this good news that comes out of a graveyard? We live in a graveyard existence. And we're always asking the question, where is the good news amidst all the death and stench of life? Well, the first thing, if you go back and refer to the gospel today, that the angel at the tomb told the women was, don't be alarmed, or do not be afraid, or as the King James puts it, fear not. You know, we've become very fearful these days. We lock ourselves in our home behind 4, 5, and 6 locks and wrought iron gates and barred windows. We can't even feel safe at church. We gotta hide security at the house of God. And not only are we prisoners in our homes, but the fear of the violence of the streets holds our minds captive and keeps our spirits bound whenever we venture out of our home. We're afraid of each other. We fear our spouses, our children, our parents, our relatives. We're threatened by our employers, skeptical of our associates and colleagues, and afraid to trust our friends. And we have forgotten that God's word tells us, fear not. God lives, beloved, and God still watches over God's own. And if God is for us, who then can prevail against us? Therefore, we need fear no power, no force, or opposition. We need fear no sickness, circumstance, or condition. No person, black or white, male or female, no angel or demon or principality, no height and no depth, nothing present and nothing to come. Fear not. For we are more than conquerors through Christ Jesus who loves us. Fear not, for he whom the Son sets free is free indeed. Fear not, beloved. The second statement that the angel made to the women here in our gospel was, he is not here, for he is risen. And beloved, that's good news. Our Lord was lied about, but lies couldn't hold him down. He's risen. Our Lord was hated, but hate couldn't hold him down. He's risen. This is not just a fairy tale or a story. We serve a risen God. His opponents were jealous of him, but jealousy couldn't hold them down. He is risen. Jesus was persecuted, but persecution couldn't even hold him down. He is risen. He was slandered, but slander couldn't hold him down. Just get in where you fit in, because some of you fit into these categories. He is risen. In the end, he was killed, but not even death, not even the grave and all the powers of hell and the forces of darkness could hold him down. He is risen. Because he lived, beloved, truth lives. Because he lives, hope endures, and love triumphs, and virtue is justified. Because he lives today, integrity is legitimated, and honesty has overcome, and righteousness is proven, and sanctification then is empowered because he lives. Because he lives, salvation has come, grace is all sufficient, and mercy is invincible. Most of all, because he lives, we live also. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he or she is a new creation. The old has passed away, and behold, all things have become new. And then the third thing that the angel told the women, he said, you know, then go quickly and tell his disciples he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee. He's going ahead of you to Galilee. You know, that's why we can walk by faith rather than sight. We know not only that our Lord walks with us, but that our Lord goes before us, ahead of us. And I don't know about you, but I'm a witness that if you trust his promises, the Lord will go before you to straighten out situations even before you get to them. The Lord will go before you into a church meeting. And by the time you get there, he will have smoothed the rough waters. I know that it gets tough sometimes, but that same Jesus who sends you into the storm is able to go before you and smooth the rough and make the crooked straight and exalt the valleys and level off the mountains. You say nothing of significance ever happened in a graveyard. I say to you that humankind's greatest discovery occurred not when the atom was split or when we learned to harness and channel the power of electricity. Neither did it take place in a school or some laboratory somewhere. Our greatest discovery occurred when a few women went to a graveyard looking to anoint the body of a dead man and discovering a living Lord with a glorified body and with the keys to hell and death and life and eternity in his hands. The greatest battle, beloved, that humankind ever fought was not at Waterloo, wasn't at Gettysburg, wasn't Hiroshima. Our greatest battle was fought in a lonely graveyard when Jesus Christ took on death and hell and the demonic evil that possessed this world. The good news that I have come to announce to you this morning, beloved, is that Jesus won.
Yes.
He is the victor now, the winner henceforth, and the champion forevermore. He is King of Kings. He is Lord of Lords. The greatest pronouncement that was ever made to humankind didn't originate at the United Nations or in the Oval Office or in the White House under some executive order, but it came rather from a graveyard. When the angel of the Lord spoke to several women and said, "Do not be afraid. I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has been raised, and he said, come see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples he has been raised from the dead, and indeed he is going ahead of you to Galilee, and there you will see him." That was the greatest pronouncement ever made. So then, it was not only in the deed of the cross, but also in all that came out of the graveyard that first Easter morning, that shows once again that God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is considered weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, things that are not, to reduce to nothing things that are. And so from a lonely graveyard comes a message that still gladdens the hearts of people everywhere who hear it. And even as we find ourselves in this existential graveyard, this message is still relevant today.